Okay, so let's start. We defined the metric on Rj. J is an index set, okay? The product, infinite product, countable, maybe not countable. And if you have 2 points, we define, so we define the metric which was called, how was it called, rho bar. So this is rho bar of xy. And this is least upper bound, supremum, least upper bound of d bar, x alpha, y alpha, x alpha, y alpha, alpha and j, where obviously x is the point x alpha, alpha and j, no? And y is y alpha, alpha and j. So the least upper bound. And what is d bar? D bar is a metric on the reals, okay? And d bar of x alpha, y alpha, this is a minimum. This is a metric. The standard metric is d, but you may write easier x alpha minus y alpha, okay? We are in the reals, okay? And then you cut at one. So this is a standard metric on the reals. Cut at 1. That's d bar. Sorry? Least upper bound, yes. Least upper bound. Supremum. Okay? Least upper. That's the book writes L-U-B. Sometimes sup. This is a uniform metric, okay? Uniform metric. That I wrote last time already. Okay, this is a uniform metric and generates uniform topology, okay? Gives uniform topology. A uniform topology. But we have the product topology, no? That was the first choice, box topology also, but so there's a theorem, and I will write but not prove. I will tell you why, not today. Theorem. So this topology is a uniform, is not the product. If J is infinite, it's strictly finer than the product topology. And the box topology is strictly finer than the, okay? So we have, if J is infinite, J infinite implies a product topology is contained but not equal a uniform topology. This is strictly finer, no? That's what it says, if it's infinite. And the uniform topology is also different from a box topology, okay? So all three are different, box. Have three different topologies. If J is finite, they are all equal. Okay? If J is infinite, they are all different. So that doesn't resolve our problem if the product topology is metrizable, okay? Or the box, but more interesting the product. No? Is there a metric? This is not the metric for the product. And there's a theorem. I'll just write you the metric. And once somebody says, well, this is the right metric, then it's easy to prove, and it's not difficult to prove, okay? It's not so interesting then. The interesting thing is to find this metric, which is the right metric for the product. It's metrizable, okay? So the theorem is the following. This is Rj. Now we have R omega. We have to go to R omega, okay? So let x, so this is xi now, I in n, and y I in n, no, the index set is a natural number. We go to the countable case. So these are elements in R omega. Okay. Now we go to R omega. And then we have D, let D let, and then we find D. D of x, y, the distance. And now we do the following. We take the least upper bound. And I write the same as here. D bar, x alpha, y alpha. This would be the uniform topology. No? And I, what is changes now is I divide by I. Sorry. There's no alpha here. It's I. Divided by I. I in n. Natural numbers now, okay? The index set. Natural numbers. I in n. This is our index set. This is more general case, okay? Arbitrary index set. Now, this means we have the natural numbers index set. And then we can divide by this number, okay? This is a uniform. So let this. Then D is a metric. This is easy. It's a metric on R omega. And now we have the product topology, which induces the product topology. So now we have a metric which induces a product. Okay? This is the product. Well, I mean, this is interesting, of course. It's more interesting to if you don't know what happens, okay? If somebody gives you the metric and says, this is metrizable, this is the right metric, then it's not so difficult. Then, I mean, you don't prove it immediately, but once your partner says, this is the right metric, okay, which induces, then you prove this is the right metric, okay? That's not too interesting and too difficult, okay? The interesting thing is if you don't know anything, then how to find this, no? Then you have to, that's interesting, okay? But I will not prove this because I will go to something which I find more interesting. This is a theorem, okay? So it's interesting theorem, certainly, no? Which is, what about if J is not countable, okay? This resolves the countable case, okay? If J is countable, okay? What happens if J is not countable? What happens with the box topology? No, that's not so interesting, but for R omega with the box topology, no, what happens? And what happens is we won't, this is the only thing which remains metrizable, no? We will prove that for the box topology is not metrizable, okay? For the product topology, if the index at J is not countable, then it's not metrizable. This is the last which is metrizable, okay? We have Rn, okay, the standard Rn. Then we have R omega, the next step. And here the product topology is metrizable, okay? And then, but the box is not metrizable, okay? And then we go to uncountable, no? And then nothing is. Of course, there's a uniform, okay, which is defined by a metric. That's okay, but we have product and box, okay, these two. Okay, so this I will not prove in this moment, maybe later, but because I want to prove that something is not metrizable, which is more interesting. Because, as I said, here you have a metric, okay? And if somebody tells you this is the right metric, then you prove after 1 or 2 hours that this is the right topology, okay? The usual lemma. More interesting is to prove it's not metrizable, because then you have to prove there's no metric, okay? And then you need a condition, no? As we said, some kind of condition, some kind of criterion, no? You have to prove, for example, if it's not Hausdorff, but that's too simple, okay? It's not Hausdorff, it's not metrizable, no? But, and we find an interesting condition, important condition. Okay, so let me start with this. Instead proving this here, the proof is in the book, of course. So there's a convergence I defined already, no? Convergence. A sequence converges to a point. If given a neighborhood of that point, there exists n, natural number, such that for all numbers larger than this, the sequence is in this neighborhood. That's a general definition of convergence, okay? I will not rewrite this. And then there is a lemma, which I prove now, easy, very easy lemma. It has a name. Because this is okay, so this is the sequence lemma. So lemma. And this is the sequence lemma. So we call it the sequence lemma. And it's easy but nice. Sequence lemma. Okay. So what? So X is topological space. X is a topological space, and A is subset of X. So there's two parts. If the first part is very easy, trivial exercise. If there's a sequence in A, if there is a sequence in A, which converges to X to a point X in X, okay? A sequence in A in the subset which converges, to a point x in x, then what happens with x? Then x is in the closure of A. Then x is in the closure of A. And this is definition, okay? I will make a picture, okay? But this is only definition, okay? Conversely, if you have the sequence. Conversely, suppose that, and now X is in the closure, and we want a sequence, okay? You're talking of limit points maybe sometimes, no? What means limit point? A sequence maybe. So conversely, but this is not true in general, okay, that I said already. Conversely, suppose that X is, and now I write metrizable for the moment, metrizable. Okay, so we need a condition now. Suppose that X is converged. Then, if X is in the closure of A, there is a sequence in A which converges to X. So then we also have the sequence. There is a sequence in A which converges to this point X. But here we have a condition. Here's no condition, no? For the other, we have a condition. So the proof is, of both directions, is very easy. Proof. If there's a sequence which converges to X, then X and A. So I make a picture, no? There's a sequence, and we recall the definitions. So what is this? X. Here's A. And here's a point X. And now we have a sequence in A which converges to X, no? So here's a sequence. AN, let's call it, okay? A sequence in A which converges to X, no? Then this is the closure. Why is it in the closure? Well, what means closure? In the closure means every neighborhood intersects. So given any neighborhood, okay, of X, U, in general, given any neighborhood, but this circumference converges to X, no? That means there is a capital N natural number such that for all natural numbers larger than this given number, the sequence is in this neighborhood, no? So the, this sequence is in this neighborhood. So the intersection is not empty, okay? With U of and A, okay? So this U intersection A certainly is not empty. Okay. That's all. Just definition. Convergence and two definitions. What is convergence and what is a point? No, that's not a definition. That's a lemma, no, a proposition. A point is in the closure of a set A if and only if every neighborhood intersects A. No, that we proved. Okay, it's not a definition, but it's very close to the definition. So this is this first part, no? By picture, you see it. It's okay. And the second part, if you want, is equally simple. So now X is metrizable. X metric. X metrizable. Metrizable. Well, metrizable. Now X is metrizable, and we have a metric D, okay? Metric D with metric D. That means D induces a given topology with metric D. And let X be in the closure, and we have to find the sequence. Okay. So now what we do is the following. Well, it's clear what to do. We have now we have the metric. We have BD, no? X 1 over I, N. I 1 over N, okay? This is the neighborhood of X, okay? So the intersection of this, this is the neighborhood of X. The intersection of this is not empty, no? Because it's a, what is the closure, no? So it's not empty. So choose a point. Okay, it's not empty, so you get a point here. You call it AN, okay? AN. Let AN be in the intersection which is not empty, okay? So you read this. Let AN be in the intersection which is not empty since it is a point in the closure. And then, that's our sequence, no? That's our proof in some sense. Then, this sequence, AN, converges to X. So proof that it converges, okay? What means convergent? Convergence means let U be a neighborhood of X. So I make it very step by step, okay? This let U be a neighborhood of X. Any neighborhood of X, okay? Open set containing X. We have to prove whatever. AN converges. That AN is in this neighborhood for large N, no? Let U be a neighborhood of X. But we have the metric topology now, okay? So there's epsilon. So I'm making two steps, okay? Maybe exaggerated. But there is epsilon bigger than zero because we have the metric. That's a ball BD around X with radius epsilon is contained in U. Okay, because this is the basis for the metric topology, no? All open balls, okay? We have a metric space now. Metrizable metric is the same now. Now we have the metric, so we call it metric space now even, okay? So this is the definition of metric topology, no? And now, of course, I choose let N be an N. Very careful, step by step. Such that 1 over n is smaller than epsilon, no? And this means what? That BD x 1 over n is contained in U. Okay? But for n bigger equal to n, of course, BD x 1 over n is contained in BD X 1 over capital N. And this is in U always, okay? It's even smaller here, no? This radius, no? Smaller, still smaller. But AN is here, no? And also an A, okay? So this implies that, what do we have to prove? So this implies for N bigger or equal to N, sometimes you have to think, what are we proving, no? AN is in U, okay? AN is in U. Right? And this means, of course, then I have no, this means that last line AN converges to X. But this is also trivial, almost definition, only definitions, no? Only definitions. So this is a sequence lemma, okay? Very easy. So I give the first application. And here, we will extract a topological condition. Now, here we have still metrizable, okay? That's a hypothesis, no? For the interesting direction, it's metrizable, no? And then it works, no? And now, but this is metric condition, no? And now we think, well, what is the topological condition such that this holds, okay? Metrizable is not so good then. Yeah? That's not a topological, that's a metric notion, no? What is a good topological condition such that the sequence lemma holds? Instead, metrizable is replaced by this topological condition, okay? Now, too weak, much too weak. Now, you don't know that. That will be first countable. We know what second countable is, okay? And here, the topological condition, we replace metrizable, which is not topological, not a metric notion, okay? We replace by a topological condition, and this will be first countable. You can think what will be first countable. That I will do later, okay? First, I give some applications. But this, you write first countable here, and then it holds. But this is a topological, first countable will be a topological condition, like second countable, okay? And then the sequence lemma holds. So here, in a natural way, you find the notion of first countable, okay, in this context. In the book, it's later, in chapter 4, okay? 2, 3, 4, yes. But I like it to do it here because it's very natural at this point, okay? Good, so some applications first. And then I introduce first countable. You can think, what is first countable? Already now, no? What is the good condition? Well, you have to imitate in some sense. What you have is, what is important is this, you know? BD, this is the important. Yeah, there's some countability here, okay? BDX 1 over N, okay? There's some countability because N, okay? So we will see. But some application first. Some nice applications of the sequence lemma. Okay, so the first is the theorem, which you let f from x to y be a function, not continuous, just a function for the moment. X metrizable, topological space, x metrizable, topological space, and y a topological space, okay? Y a topological space. Not, we don't care here, topological space. Okay, so this is our situation. Then, f is continuous, if and only if. If and only if f is continuous, if and only. We want to use sequences now, okay? In analysis, that's standard, no? So for every convergent sequence in X, the image is convergent in Y, okay? So the notion will be for every convergent sequence in X, for every convergent sequence xn, which converges to x in x, the image sequence what? Sometimes. Yeah. Sometimes. Yeah, not always, no. In other words, you have epsilon delta, no. You have also, what? Sometimes this, one of the definitions, yes, right. Sometimes you use epsilon delta, or the best definition in some sense is preimages of open sets are open, also in analysis. No, they are all, in analysis, they are all equivalent. In the situation of analysis, okay, for Rn. Analysis is in Rn mainly, no? The image sequence f of xn converges to f of x. So maybe I should write f of xn converges. That's what it means, no? To f of x. Okay. If and only if. So one direction, you don't need metrizable, no? One direction is always true, okay? So proof. That is the not interesting condition. This is this condition, okay. This direction, sorry. This one. If f is continuous, no? If f is continuous, then this holds. Well... so let f be continuous, no? And xn converges to x. How to write? We have to prove that f of xn converges to f of x. So let v be a neighborhood of... It's almost automatic, without thinking, no? Let v be a neighborhood of f of x. And we have to prove that f of xn is in this neighborhood for large n, okay? That's convergent. Let v be neighborhood of f of x. Yeah, the f inverse of v is the easiest, no? Then f inverse of v, so u, which is f inverse of v, it's a neighborhood of x, such that f of u contained in V. This is a local continuity. Now, given the neighborhood of the image, there's a neighborhood of X such that F of U contained in V. And you can take the whole pre-image, okay? Because pre-image of open sets are open anyway. So it's a neighborhood of X such that F of U. What, sorry. So we have that Xn, yeah, right, Xn converges to X. So there is capital N in N, such that f of x, xn is in u for n bigger or equal to capital N. That's a convergence, no? And this in. For n in N, f of xn is contained in f of u. So, which is a subset of V. Sorry, for N, for N bigger or equal to capital N, no? I didn't want to write to this n here. I wanted to write these two. Okay, for n bigger or equal to capital in f and f, and this of course means then f of x n converges to f of x. Okay, so we just apply definitions. Not so interesting, no. And we don't need that x is metrizable. Okay, this is a general fact. Okay, we do not need. We didn't need. That x is metrizable. So this is more general, okay? If a function is continuous, then for any continuous function, convergent sequences go to convergent sequences, okay? For any continuous function. Interesting is the other direction, no? That this is sufficient. So this is interesting. And here we need metrizable. Well, we may say maybe also not here, but there are counterexamples. So it's not true. It's not true otherwise, in general. So what we have to prove? So f is continuous. So here we use this strange criterion, or not strange, no. Continuous equivalent to f of the closure of A is contained in the closure of f of A, okay? F of the closure of A is contained in the closure of f of A, okay? So that's equivalent to continuity, okay? And it's convenient here because we have the sequence lemma, no? So let A, how's it called? A, sorry. B in X. We prove that F of the closure of A, as I said, F of the closure A is contained in the closure of F of A. Okay? And this implies f is continuous. Okay. And this is now, again, easy. Once we say, well, if we use this for continuity, then this is also easy now, okay? It's automatic. So f of the closure of A. So let x be in the closure of A, okay? Let x, without thinking now. Now it's, once you start in this in the right way, then it's okay. Let x be in the closure of A. And now important, where is it? X metrizable. X is metrizable, okay? Build an x. So x metrizable. X is metrizable. What does it say? So the sequence lemma, what does it say? The sequence lemma, what does it imply? Exactly what is here, no? There is a sequence. No. The sequence lemma is not, sorry, this is not the sequence lemma, this is what we are proving. So the sequence lemma applies. There is a sequence. An in A which converges to X. So we write this An converges to X. Okay? There's a sequence in A which converges to X. And here we use metrizable. Here we use metrizable metrics. So we use the metric here to prove them. It's interesting to see if it's necessary, no, also. If you have to use it. Or something. If it's true without, no, it's not true. And then, what is our hypothesis here? We are in this direction here, no? So this implies f of an converges to f of x. So then f of an, sorry, f of an converges to f of x. Well, Now we have the trivial direction of, by the other direction of the sequence, the trivial direction of the sequence ever. Now by the trivial direction, the less interesting inclusion, inclusion direction of the sequence lemma. What we get, f of x is in. So this is a sequence in f of a, no? Okay. Because of course this is in f of a. If you have a sequence in something which converges to a point, then this point is the closure of f of a. So. Okay, that's it, no? That's the proof. F is continuous, no? That's a nice proof, no? This criterion, okay. Now I give some other applications. As I said, we know now, I told you, that R omega with the product topology is metrizable, no? I gave you the metric. I didn't prove that this is the right metric, but that's not very difficult, okay? Once you have the right metric, and then you prove that is so. And now we want to prove what is sometimes more. Well, it's interesting to find the metric, as I said, okay? What is the right metric, no? If you don't know the metric, then of course it's interesting how to find, no? How does it make it? So you have the uniform metric and you modify it a little bit, no? And then it works for the product topology, no? What is interesting is to prove it's not metrizable, no? And that will I prove, no? So, as another application, no? Okay. So, we prove two things. The first one is proposition, I call proposition. And we have R omega again, countable product of reals, no? R omega with the box topology is not metrizable. Omega with a box topology is not metrizable. So we use a sequence lemma. That's the criterion, okay? If it's metrizable and something is in the closure of a point, then we find a sequence, okay? If it's metrizable. So if you don't find a sequence, it's not metrizable. So what we want to do here is we want to define a subset, okay, the upper half space, and we have a point in the closure, and then we prove there's no sequence which converges to this point in the upper half, okay? And then the sequence lemma says it's not metrizable, no? That's the whole point, okay? So we use the sequence lemma to distinguish metrizable from. So proof. So A, so as I said, we define a subset of R omega and the point in the A, and the point in the closure, which will be zero, okay? And then we prove there's no sequence in the A with the upper half space. So what is the upper half space? So let A be the upper half space in our omega, that means these are all points with positive coordinates, okay? So all xn, n in n. So of course xn is in the reals, okay? Anyway, we are in R omega, okay? Xi I wrote before, now it's xn, but it's the same, no? But xn is bigger than zero, okay? This is the upper half space, okay? In Rn, no? Upper half space. Avoiding also zero, okay? The upper, open upper half space, no? Upper half space. In R omega, that's what it is. Okay. And zero is zero, okay? Zero, so it's zero, zero, zero. So maybe this zero is a little bit bigger than this, but it's, you cannot see it, okay? So this is in R omega. That's a vector space anyway, okay? So it's zero in R omega, no? And this is zero in the reals, okay? Constant. Then, clearly, zero is in the closure of A. What is our topology? Box, no? We have to think of the box topology. We are in the box topology. So this is in the closure of A. Well, easy, no? If you think a little bit about zero in closure. If you take any neighborhood of zero, no? In the box topology, that you take a basis neighborhood, okay? Basis element. That is a product of open sets. Okay, in each open set, you find open intervals because of reals, okay? And then in each open interval, in each coordinate, you find positive points. That's all, no? So maybe I write the proof here. Is this okay? Let u be a neighborhood of zero. So then, well, I will write this careful now, almost too careful, okay? So by the definition of the box topology, no, we have a basis element. So then this implies zero is contained, and now we find this product, no? Product un, n in n, contained in u. Where un is open in the reals, no? Okay, and contains zero, no? Because zero is in this product, no? Contains zero in R. Okay. The product of open sets, no? The box topology, the bases are arbitrary products of open sets, okay? Box? The box topology. Arbitrary products of open sets. The product topology, not arbitrary products. Products of open sets, but you have the whole space, okay? Except for finitely many indices. That makes a big difference, no? Well, here not, of course. I mean, here it's... So, then, of course, we can find intervals, no? We are in the standard topology in R, no? This is, un is open in the reals and contains zero, and also we find an interval, no? That means that... zero, of, obviously, now I take another product. I take a product n in n, and now I take minus epsilon n, epsilon n, okay? Which is a small interval around zero. Minus epsilon n, epsilon n. Contained in product un, n in n, contained in u. Maybe I'm exaggerated, no? But I start with an arbitrary open set, no? Then by the definition, I find the basis element, which is this one, and then I find also these intervals, no? And now you can write down explicitly the point of the intersection, no? So then What is the point intersection? Epsilon n over 2, n in n, is where? Well, it's in A, because it's all positive, no? These are positive. Epsilon n, as usual, no? Minus epsilon n, epsilon n, okay? So this is in A, no, clearly. Where should it be? And in U. Also in U, okay, yes. It's positive coordinates, and it's in U, because it's here, no, in this part. Okay. And this means what we want. So this means that 0 is in the closure of A. No, sorry, 0 is in the closure of A. Okay. So this is easy, no? That's not the main part. Now what we want to prove, and that there's no sequence in A which converges to 0. It's in the closure, but there's no sequence. So this is an example, or one of these examples, where you have something in the closure of a subset, but you don't find a sequence, okay? I told you, it's not, it's a limit point, it is, no? But you don't get it as a limit, okay? So let's see. And this is a famous argument. I mean, it's not exactly, but almost a famous argument, which is the argument of Cantor, the diagonal argument, okay? Now you see a version of the diagonal argument of Cantor. Cantor, no? Which is, who proved that the reals are not countable. And he used the diagonal argument, okay? And now we see such a diagonal argument. So what we have to prove is that there is no sequence in A convergence, no sequence, okay? Not a single sequence. That's what we want to prove, okay? No sequence in A converging to 0. So we take any sequence, okay? We take any sequence in A. And we prove 0 is not the limit, okay? So given any sequence, let AN be any sequence in A. Let A1 AN be any sequence in A. Take any sequence. So we have A1, A2, A3, and so on. No? That's a sequence in A. A is, of course, where? In R, we are in R omega, no? Anyway, okay? In R omega. So each AN, what is it? Is a real sequence. Okay? Each element of R omega is a real sequence. So what? So where AN, so each AN is a real sequence, okay? It's an element of R omega. So this is, well, which index N? I don't know. It takes a second one. N is fixed here, no? And you have x1n, x2n, x3n, and so on, no? This is an element in R omega, okay? The elements of R omega are real sequences. So this is, in other words, it's x, and now I in n, no? In R omega. This or this way, so right, okay? Here I write the first three, I write, I need another index here, okay? X, I, n. Yes, what else? Well, yes, we are, of course, in A, no? We are in A. A and C, that means these are positive. We are in the upper half space, positive, okay? Positive upper half space. So, and X, I, n are all bigger than 0. We are in the positive upper half space of R omega. That's A. Okay, and now we prove that this sequence, which is completely arbitrary, cannot converge to 0. Okay. So let U be any neighborhood of 0. Okay. Let U. Do I have a U here already? Well, I have it here, but this, I don't care about this. This was before, okay. Let U be any neighborhood of 0 in A, in where are we? R omega. R omega with a box topology, no? We have the box topology, with box topology. So again, we cannot describe an arbitrary neighborhood, okay? But we have the basis, no? What does it mean? So we have a basis element which contains zeros contained here, no? The basis element of the product topology, of the box topology, arbitrary products of open sets, okay? So then, well, in one or two steps, no? I will make one step, no? You find the neighborhood, well, UN, I don't have. So again, well, let's do it very, in two steps. In product UN, N in N. One second. Yeah, for, well, contained in U. Okay. This is open in where? In R. And zero is in UN. As before, no, that we did before. No. This is the basis element of the product topology, no? Basis element of product of the product topology. That is the basis element of the product. And UN is open reals and contains 0. And so we can again find an interval. As before, it's the same as before. No? So this means that, what? Sorry?
Of the box topology.
Yes, box. Box. Yes. Box topology. We have only the box topology. Thanks. Okay. Then well, what is I'm doing writing too much. Sorry, I was. That's not necessary. What do we have to prove? We have to find one neighborhood. Just one neighborhood, okay? Here I give an arbitrary neighborhood now, okay? That's not necessary, so forget about it. Here I write any neighborhood, okay? That's not necessary, okay? So. I just need one neighborhood, okay? Which doesn't fulfill this condition, okay? Just one. And as I said, this is a diagonal, okay, argument. So I give immediately this one neighborhood. Then U is equal, no, explicit, okay? Not any neighborhood, just one. And this is. So we have this situation here, okay? With these, all these numbers, two indices, okay, I and n. N is, yeah, two indices, no? We have a sequence of sequences, no? A sequence of real sequences, no? That's what it is. A sequence of real sequences. Now I take minus x11. I go to the diagonal, okay? Where the indices are equal. Minus x, they're positive. Times minus x22, x22. Times minus x33, x33. Times. So in general, it's a product of whatever it is. No, you did not write. So it's a product of xnn, nnn, minus xnn, xnn, the diagonal, okay, nnn. Product minus of these intervals, okay? First times, times, times. So this is a neighborhood of zero, okay? Because these are positive, all zero is always here. It's a neighborhood of zero in R omega. Certainly it's a neighborhood of zero in the box topology, no? Arbitrary product of open sets. So it's a neighborhood of zero in the box topology, such that, and now the conclusion is such that such that, well, AN maybe I was not too careful with these indices. It's not in U for any n in n. Not a single one is in this neighborhood of these four elements, okay? Not one. And why not? Since? Well, we are looking at the nth coordinate, no? Since the nth coordinate of this is ANN, no? This is a sequence. Since ANN is not an element of minus ANN, ANN, this is the open interval, no? So it goes wrong in the nth coordinate, okay? This AN is not in U, it's not here. We're looking at the nth coordinate, and we are, okay? XN, we avoided XNN, okay? Well, and this, of course, means then this sequence AN does not converge to zero. But this is an arbitrary sequence. So. Okay? So then, by the sequence lemma, R omega is not metrizable by the sequence lemma. R omega is not metrizable. R omega with a box topology. It's not metrizable. Okay. So here's the application of the sequence. So what is the classical diagonal argument of Cantor? That the reals are not. Let's talk. So, because so the classical diagonal argument of Cantor okay. So we have a sequence of real numbers, okay? Take any sequence of real numbers. Take a sequence, consider a sequence of real numbers. Maybe you know, who knows this argument? The diagonal argument of Cantor? Not. So it's okay that we do it. Consider sequence of real numbers. Well, just the idea. In 0, 1. Okay? In the interval. Any sequence, no? We want to prove that this is not countable. So if you take a sequence, you never get everything, okay? That's what we prove. We don't get everything, okay? You cannot take this, you cannot count this, okay? You cannot, this is not, in, you cannot count first, second, okay? You never get everything. That means the real numbers, or this, is not countable, okay? You cannot count this, no? That's what it means, okay? So I take a sequence, okay? Arbitrary sequence. And I will prove this cannot be all, no? There are always other elements, okay? And this is a diagonal argument. So consider a sequence an of real numbers, okay? Well, now I write a real number. What is a real number? That's not so trivial, no? But a real number is, so a1 is equal to 0. No? Decimal expansion. No? It's not unique, okay? So, but we don't care here. We don't. So 0 times, okay? A1. So we have x11, x21. The n was the second index. No, it doesn't matter, really. x31, and so on. So where are these numbers? Xij are now, they are between 0 and 9, no? That's a decimal, no? Between 0 and 9. Between 0, 1, 9. Right? 1/2 is 0, 5, okay? 1/3. Is 0, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, forever, okay? And so on. A2 is 0, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 2. A3, 0, x, 1, 3, x, 2, 3, x, 3, 3. And so on, okay? It's not completely unique, no? You have always this problem with 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, okay? That's 1. 0, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9 is 1. And 1 is 1. But, well, we have 0 here, but you can start later, no? 0, 1, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, 9, So it's 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. No? So it's not completely unique. And then I define now diagonal. I now go to the diagonal, OK? That's why it's called diagonal argument. I look, what's the diagonal here? This, 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 OK? This is the diagonal, no? And now I define y, or b, equal 0 point b1, b2, b3, where of course also this b, I are in, well, I define it, you know, okay? Let b be this element, okay? Such that bi, bn, b whatever. Bi. I'm confused with I and N, no? Two indices. Is equal to well, what is the standard choice? Huh? You mind this one, this one, this one, this one. I want to change. I want, yeah, I look at it, but I exactly don't want this one. Okay? Here I don't want this. Here I don't want this. Here I don't want this. You say exactly the opposite, okay? But that's the idea, okay? You avoid this now, okay? So you don't take the diagonal, but you change, okay? So the one choice is take zero. If you say x, I is different from zero. Okay? If you see something here which is different from zero, then you write zero. If it's zero, then you write one. So something different, okay? One, if x I is equal to zero. If it's equal to zero, then you have one, okay? And this implies that this should, one has to be a little bit careful. I mean, this is just the idea, okay? One has, because it's not unique, no? That's a crucial point. But this implies that, should imply that B is different from AN for all N. Okay. Because you look at the diagonal, and there it's different, okay? So here it's different, here it's different, here it's different. And okay, so you compare. This is a rough version of the classical diagonal of Cantor, okay? Okay. So just because this is a famous point, this is a classical diagonal argument of Cantor. So what is the consequence? This implies R is not countable, no? Since this subset is not countable, okay. Okay. Now the last application, the next application, last application, obviously. So we say this R omega is a box topology. No, well, the box topology is not the most important topology. It's interesting, but not okay. What about product topology? No, R omega is a product topology. Is metrizable? No, that's a theorem which I wrote the metric but didn't prove. No, what R J is product topology? No, for under J. No, and so. The next proposition is exactly this proposition. If J is uncountable, then if F is uncountable, then RJ with a product topology is not metrizable. And now here we have the good topology, the product topology, you know, but it's not metrizable, also this one. So the last one, except for the uniform, these are all metrizable, no? But between product and box topologies, the last one which is metrizable is R omega with the product, okay? R omega with the product. Everything else, box product, is no longer metrizable. Proof. The proof is very similar to the other proof. Same idea, except we now. We have to think what one has to define A differently. Okay, what is A in this case? So A, let A be. So now we are in RJ, no? That's our space, RJ, no? let A be a subset equal of all points x alpha in Rj, x alpha, alpha in J, that's the way how we write, in Rj, such that all x alpha, such that x alpha is equal to zero, for finitely many values of alpha, x alpha is equal to zero, can be equal to zero for finitely many, only for finitely many values of alpha. Okay, it can be zero for finitely many, and one for everything else, for all others one, and one, maybe always one, no, for no value, but and one for all other values. Of alpha. So this is the definition of A. It's a subset of Rj, obviously. No? This is now our subset of Rj, which will work. And again, we have zero. So now it's zero. So let zero, write zero. Yes, now it's zero, but alpha in J, no? Be zero in Rj. Then, zero is again in the closure of A. So we again should prove this. Zero is in the closure of A, okay? So take any neighborhood of zero, okay? But now I will write the standard neighborhood, the basis element, okay? If we start with an arbitrary neighborhood, then we find a basis element, okay, which contains and is a neighborhood, okay? So I will avoid now, okay, starting with an arbitrary neighborhood. So let so what is a let a product of U alpha, alpha in J, be a basis element for the product topology containing zero. And we have to prove that the intersection with A is not empty, no? That's what we have to prove. Basis element for the product of will be containing zero. We are in the product topology, so that means U alpha, so this implies U alpha is different from zero, it's different from the reals, only for finitely many indices, okay? Only for finitely many indices. Well, alpha 1, alpha n, I suppose. Alpha 1, alpha n. In J. Okay, and now we found the point in the intersection, X alpha. So let's, what does it mean? U alpha, a basis element for the product. So containing zero. So zero is in U alpha, no? I should have, so this means zero is in U alpha, no, of course. And U alpha is open in R, no? U alpha open in R. Well, I didn't write, but it's clear. The important thing is this then also, no? And now I take point X alpha. In Rj, alpha in J, sorry. Such that X alpha is equal to. So we define the point in the intersection. What we have to be careful in the intersection of what? Of A and this is our neighborhood, no? And A, okay? A is this strange definition, no? Zero for finitely many and one, okay? So what do we do? We take x alpha 1, okay, 1, if this is the reals, we can take 1, okay, no problem. So this means if alpha is different from these indices, no? Alpha 1, alpha n. Finitely many. Then we take 1. And for the other one, the only point we know is 0. And 0 if alpha is equal to alpha 1, alpha n, is equal to 1 alpha n, okay? Right? And that means we are in A, and we are also in this neighborhood. So this means an x alpha. This point x alpha, alpha in J, certainly is in A, because 1 always, except for finitely many, we have a 0, no? And it's obviously in this product here. So intersection product U alpha alpha J. So this means that this is not empty, this intersection. And this means then finally that 0 is in the closure. Okay? This is an arbitrary neighborhood, basis element. And this implies then that 0 is in the closure of A again, as before. It's in the closure of A. Okay? And now we do the same. We take an arbitrary sequence and we prove it does not converge to 0, okay? So again, sequence lemma implies not Mach 1. No, as before. Same structure of proof as before, exactly the same. The detail is a little bit different, but so let's take an arbitrary sequence. So let A, what was it called? An, no? In the first proof. So we use the same notation. So let An be a sequence in A, any sequence. Let An be any sequence in A, which is the subset of RJ. So each An, what is it? So in some sense, an, let me write it, I didn't write here, but this is a, x, in the notation before, okay, the coordinates, alpha n, alpha was the first index now, okay, alpha, this alpha in j, this is an element of rj, no? Each is this type, no? That's not the sequence now, okay, because what did I write? J is uncountable, no? Did I write that in the proposition? J is not countable, okay? So this is not a sequence now, no? You cannot give a reasonable order. First, second, third, no? It's not a sequence. But it's an element in RJ. And but we are in A. You know, what was the definition of A? Definition of A is that we have finitely many 0 and 1 for all others, okay? Finitely many 0 and then 1, always 1. So we want to see where 0, okay? So we call Jn, let Jn. So I want, for each An, I want to have the indices where 0, okay? This is finite set. So these are all x alpha n, are all indices here, alpha in j, such that this is 0. X alpha n is 0. Okay, n is fixed now. Okay, x alpha n is 0. And so this is a finite, okay, by the definition of A. Finite with many zeros. It's not zero. No, zero. Finite, it's zero for finitely many indices, and it's one for all others, okay? I want the finitely many. So this is finite by the definition of A, okay? This is finite, Jn. Okay. Well, maybe this we don't need. This was a proof that it's in boundary, so we don't need this anymore. So now I take the union Jn, n in n. For each n, I have the coordinates where it's zero, no, finite set. Now I take the union of these. So these are finite. This is countable union of finite sets. This is in J. Okay. Yes, this is countable. A countable union of finite sets. Okay, it's countable. No, a countable union. Of finite sets. That's what it is. It's countable. Yes, right. Is that clear? Or? Yeah. But so we have finite sets. Well, this is some argument counting like this, no? Even a countable union of countable set is countable, no? Countable union of countable set is countable, no? Countable union of countable sets. Here's the first countable set. The second countable set. The third countable set, okay? And then you have a countable union of countable sets, and then you count. How do you count? Yes, you start on the left, then you go, you count in this way, no? This. Yeah, and so on. You get everything, okay? Countable union of countable sets is countable. Countable union of finite sets is countable, okay? And this is uncountable. Right? By hypothesis. So they are not equal. Countable, non-countable, no? They are not equal. Right? So I take any point in J, let whatever is called beta. Okay, choose beta in J, beta not in this union. What does it mean? Then, for x beta n. So beta is fixed now, no? And x beta n, we avoid it where it's zero, can be zero. So it's always one now, okay? The zero we excluded now. No, it's one. For all n in n. It's always one, because the zeros we have here, the indices. So here, choose beta fixed now, beta, and then this is one, always one. We get always one now. Which topology do we have? Product, no? Product. So I need one neighborhood of the product topology of zero. which avoids the sequence. Okay. Here we have this sequence, any sequence. No. Okay. And we have I define it. No, it's clear. This neighborhood. It's one line now. The proof. Okay. Now I give you the neighborhood. So I take that then. U, I don't have here, no. U equal pi beta, this is a projection on this coordinate, okay? Pi beta minus 1 of minus 1, 1, open interval. Minus, I take this open interval in the reals. This is projection, no, on the coordinate. This is continuous, no? So this is open. So this is a neighborhood of zero. It's zero goes to this, no? It's a neighborhood of zero. This certainly is a neighborhood of zero because this is continuous. Of zero where? Of zero in RJ. This is a neighborhood, no? And it contains zero such that such as what? An is not in this neighborhood for all n, such that an is not in U for all n in n. Since, I say, it contains not a single element of this sequence, okay? Not one. So the sequence cannot converge, okay? There's no sequence which converges, no? Because this is an arbitrary sequence, okay? Since an is not in U, since a beta n which is what? 1, no? Okay. A beta n, this is 1. Now x. Okay, I called it x the coordinates, no, not a. X beta n is 1. It's not an element where in. So the projection goes to 1. Okay, over here with minus 1, 1. Okay, so it's not here. So it's not in minus 1, 1. We avoid, no? The n, the beta's coordinate is 1, okay? And then you take the projection on the beta's coordinate, it's 1. So it's not here. Okay? So it's not in U. So this means then, again, to conclude, so this implies this sequence AN does not converge against zero. And now again, the sequence lemma says, implies RJ is not metrizable. Okay, in this situation, not metrizable. So what is the situation? The situation is that J is infinite, that J is uncountable, and this has a product topology, okay? J uncountable. RJ with product topology, okay? Okay. So this is a proof of the proposition. Well, it's perfect because it seems. Yeah, also here. Yeah. Exactly. So these are three nice applications. No? We have the sequence lemma, and we have these are three nice applications. No, the first one is the continuity. No, if under some hypothesis, a function is continuous if a convergent, if and only if a convergent sequence goes to a convergent sequence. No, that's the first application. The second one is R omega with a box topology is not metrizable, and the third one R J if there is uncountable, the product topology is not metrizable. Okay, so these are the three applications we saw today for the sequence. And now we have also the situation, this limit point stuff. No, limit point is a very weak definition. Limit point means every neighbor. Limit point of A means every neighborhood of A intersects of x intersects A in a point different from x. So intersects A minus x, okay? X might be in A or not in A, that's not so clear, okay? If x is not in A, then anyway. But that's very weak, okay? If it's Hausdorff, no? Then in any neighborhood, we have infinitely many different points. But this is still not limit point exactly, no? And then we would have a sequence. But that's in general, this shows it's not possible, okay? We have a limit point. We have a point in the. We have a limit point here. Now we have a point in the closure. Okay, it's not 0, 0, 0 is not in A. No, it's not a point in A. It's a limit point of A. No, it's in the closure. It's a limit point. Okay, A is finitely many zeros. Okay, it's a point. And 0, 0, 0, everything zero. So it's a limit point of A 0. It's Hausdorff. These spaces are all Hausdorff, okay? So any neighborhood intersects in infinite many points, but you don't construct a sequence in general, okay? You cannot find a sequence by this proposition and also by the preceding one, okay? We have two examples where we have such a situation that you have a limit point, but you have infinitely many points in the intersection, okay? But you cannot choose a sequence which converges, okay? The spaces are too large for that, okay? So this notion limit point is a little bit misleading then, no? It's not a limit, okay? But it's called limit point in the book, so, okay? That's interesting point, okay? And tomorrow I will give you first countable, no? What is behind? This is metric, no? We have metrics in the sequence lemma, no? So now we have to replace this metrizable by some topological condition, no? Which allows the same proofs, okay? That's easy. Well, tomorrow I define first countable.